Crossing is a brand new church coming to South Surrey. We're encouraged by how many people are moving to South Surrey. And so our heart is to share Jesus with these people, to help people to know who He is and how He can change their lives. We just gather every Sunday in hopes that we together as a community can reach this community. Father, thank you for paying the price for our sin, for taking on everything that we've done. God, may we not underestimate your power in this place. May we not underestimate who you are. May we seek your glory, not our own. And as we gather here as the church, as your bride, as your body, Lord God, may we experience you in a new way. May we see your face. May you reveal to us things in our hearts and in our lives that need to be revealed. But mostly, God, may we remember whose we are. And may we find the very core of our identity in that today. So as we hear from your word, may it sink deeply into our souls, God. And may we remember today that we belong to you, God. Not our jobs, not our obligations, not anything else, God. We belong to you. We love you. In your name. Amen. You guys can all have a seat. And finally, today, I just have a special morning this morning as my good friend Andrew. You can come up now, man. He's going to come bring the word to us this morning. And I really believe in what God is going to speak to us through him today. So why don't you join me and maybe stretch out a hand as we pray for God's word to just reach us. Lord God, we want to hear from you today. Thank you for giving us your servant today, Andrew, to share these words with us. Lord God, your word pierces through our hearts. It reaches us in every single capacity. And we want to be reached this morning. We want to posture ourselves in such a way that we hear from you today. So be with Andrew. May your words be spoken through his mouth. We love you. In your name, amen.
I want to start this morning with just continuing in that state of worship, because I'll say it again. I know I've said it before, but the word of God is worship, just as much as music is worship, as prayer is worship. It's all worship to him, but it's only worship if today we allow the word to saturate our hearts in such a way that we're becoming like Jesus. If we're just learning about him, it doesn't matter. It's not worship. It's just study. You're just a student, but you want to be like him. So let's just pray again, God. We just want to open this place up to your presence, Father. We just want you to come and meet with each one of us, Lord. We just want our walls to be broken down, the things that are in our lives that hold us back from being like you to be surrendered, God. Lord, we give you our lives, Father, even right now, Father, that there's an anointing upon this place, God, that anyone who has stuff, that has baggage, that has relationship issues, that has financial issues, that needs healing, God, if there are necks that need healing right now, God, if there are backs that need healing, Lord, if there are diseases and things in our lives that need healing that only you can do, Father, we believe that you're going to do it, God. We believe right now that you're going to do it, Father, throughout this service, throughout today, that you can do it, Jesus. So, Lord, we just offer it all up to you, God. We lift up this message to you and the scriptures that we're about to hear from. Lord, just let it resound in our soul and speak life to us afresh, God, that we would just release all our burdens and enter into the rest that you've called us to live in. Lord, we just thank you. We lay it all down before you in Jesus' name. Amen. So before I can even start with what God has really been placing on my heart to say, is I have to tell you a sermon that my two-year-old daughter gave to me this morning when I was studying what I'm about to speak about. She just said these words. I was just sitting on my bed. She came up to me and said, "Daddy, Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you, Dad." She just kept saying it. And I was like, yeah, you know, if you don't get out of anything else today, just get that. Jesus loves you. The Father who created all of this made you the center point of it all, the focal point of it all, that he loves you. And if that doesn't break your heart, even if you're 40 years in the Lord, it doesn't matter, like, get with it. That's what Jesus came here to say. I love you. And he came to say that to the whole world. And so today we're back in the Beatitudes, and Brent's been doing a great job of leading us through it. And I'm on verse 8 today, which is, "How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." And you got to read the Beatitudes that way, because it's not like, blessed are these people, blessed is this, and blessed is that. It's really, God, Jesus is saying there, how blessed are the pure in heart. You guys, you're pure in heart. How blessed are you? You're going to see God. Isn't it amazing? And I bet if I was to ask every single one of you in some way who are believers here today that you have seen God, and even some of you who aren't believers, I bet you've seen God in some way. I can go through incredible experiences where God has given me dreams and visions. I could tell you about times where I've seen incredible financial blessing that doesn't make any sense at all, where $10,000 ended up in my bank account at the end of 3 months, where my wife and I were working just to pay our bills, and there was no possible way that could ever happen without God. God has done so much greater things where I've seen him, and I know that you have seen him too. And so I want to dive into this with the title, that believing is seeing. That this world may tell you that seeing is believing, but God says no. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Taste first, believe in me, and you will see me. So let's develop this message in two ways. And I want to begin with the fact that we need to understand the identity of Christ, and then we need to move into our identity in Christ. So let's look at these two words, pure in heart, from the Greek words for pure. So everybody say katharos. Katharos. It means pure. It means more than that. It means clean. It means blameless. It means unstained from guilt. Blameless. Hold that word in your mind. Secondly, cardia. Say cardia. Heart. That can mean your physical heart, but it can also mean the spiritual center of your life. It's where your thoughts and your desires are, your will, your understanding, your purpose, your character. This is what it means to have your heart. So what is Jesus saying here? Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the blameless inside of you. Blessed is everything inside of you that is blameless. So let me ask you this question. Who came here today and said, yes, I am blameless in everything? Anybody? You're too humble. You are too humble. So let's look at some scriptures that kind of help us to understand what it means to be pure in heart. Let's turn to Hebrews 12:14. It'll be on the screen. It says, "Keep pursuing peace with everyone and the holiness without which no one will see the Lord." All right, we're talking about the pure in heart will see God. And now it gives you two more qualifiers for seeing God. It's those who are peacemakers and those who are holy. So who of you came here today saying, yeah, I'm holy and set apart and I'm a peacemaker? Revelations 21:22-27. John, in the letter of Revelation, talking about the new Jerusalem that God is preparing, says this, "I saw no temple in the city, for Adonai, God of heaven's armies, is the temple, as is the Lamb. The city has no need of the sun or moon to shine on it, because God's glorious manifest presence gives its light. And its lamp is the Lamb. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring its splendor into it. Its gates will never close. It will stay open all day, because night will not exist there, and the honor and splendor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure may enter it, nor anyone who does shameful things or lies. The only one who may enter it are those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life." Nothing impure may enter this city. Only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's heavy. Because if you don't feel pure today, let me rephrase that. It's not about feeling pure. It's if you aren't pure today, then your name's not written in the Book of Life. That's hard. Because I thought Jesus' yoke was easy and his burden was light. But we have to see this, that pure in heart has another interrelated meaning. It means to be single-minded. And Jesus defines what it means to be single-minded. And in the Beatitudes, in Matthew 5, 6, he talks about a whole lot of stuff. He gives a whole lot of commands that are just incredibly hard. But he says all of this. If you are single-minded, and now let's go to Matthew 6, 33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. So you seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all this stuff that he's been talking about that seems really hard. Be blameless. Be perfect. Don't worry about what you're going to eat, what you're going to wear. Don't get angry. It'll all follow as we seek his kingdom and his righteousness. So what is his kingdom? What is his righteousness? It's your heavenly dad's rule and reign on this earth. And the way that that comes about is by you obeying his commands and his spirit. So it's all about obedience to God and our day-to-day lives to bring about what God wants to do in this world. So if you're single-minded, you don't have to worry so much about what you're doing. You have to worry more about who you're being. So let me try to explain this to you through my life. I'm a painter 5 days a week, sometimes more. I love the scriptures. I went to school for this. And more than that, I love teaching. I love getting into the Word of God. I love it, especially in a smaller setting where I can ask you questions and we can have dialogue and we can grill each other. We can really get to the core of the truth of Scripture and to learn how to be like Jesus together. I love it. So I'm constantly torn between two worlds, my job as a painter and my desire to be doing this more and spending more of my time in it. But when we become single-minded on the kingdom and his righteousness, all that stuff starts to fade away. It's not so much about what we're doing anymore. It's not about whether I'm a painter today and a plumber tomorrow or something else. It doesn't matter where God leads me. He can lead me into any sphere of this world, into business, into anything. And I can know that my mission is to bring and advance his kingdom in this world. And I can have peace. And it doesn't matter because I'm being like Jesus. So we know that God desires a single-minded, blameless people for himself. And the question is how? A lot of times we approach the scriptures and we're like, we want to funnel everything to Jesus. But I think that it needs to start with Jesus and end with Jesus too, but it needs to start with Jesus. So let's begin by looking at God's promises to Abraham, because we will find Jesus there. The Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your native land and from your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and curse him that curses you, and all the families of the earth shall bless themselves by you." So even though Abraham doesn't recognize it at this moment, to say that God is going to bless all the nations through him means that the Messiah is going to come through his lineage. But the question is still how. And we find that as we go to Genesis 15, verse 7. And we start reading there, and he says, "Then he said to him, 'I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to assign you the land to as a possession.' And he said, Abraham said, 'O Lord God, how shall I know that I am to possess it?' And he answered, 'Bring me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old she-goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young bird.' So he brought him all these, and then he cut them in two, placing them opposite each other. But he did not cut up the bird. Suddenly, birds of prey descended on him, and Abraham drove them all away. As the sun was about to set, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and a great dark dread descended upon him." So Abram wants to know for sure that God is actually going to hold to his promise. And God says, "I'm going to give you a great nation. I'm going to give you lots of descendants. I'm going to give you a land. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless other people through you." And Abram's like, "Wow, that's amazing. Prove it." And so God says, "Sure, go and get me some stuff, some five animals." And the interesting thing is, you know, why? Why are these animals? And how did Abram know to cut them up? So clearly there's something in the context of the history that Abram knew that we don't always see. So the answer is that these animals were clean animals.
They're considered clean right from the time of Noah, where God separated the clean and the unclean. And Abraham would have knew this. And also further, as we see the sacrificial system come into Israel, these animals were used all the time for sacrifice in the temple system. So Abraham knew that they were clean. He knew that it was for a sacrifice. And he knew that it was for a covenant. So he cuts them up and he sets them on two different opposing sides. And this is what happens. Abram knows it's a covenant because he's seen this lots of times in marriage covenants. Back in the day, his day, not our day, Abram was used to seeing marriage covenants between a greater and lesser party. So a covenant is actually always between a greater and lesser party. And when we talk about a marriage covenant today, it's not the man and the woman who are the greater or lesser party. It's God and the couple who are the greater and lesser party. In that day and age, it would have been the groom who was the greater party and the bride who was the lesser party. And they would come together, and the bride and the groom would have their parents there, obviously. And they would bring these animals, and they would sacrifice them into a nice little pool of blood. And they would come, and they would make their vows to each other. So the groom would come, and his father would represent his groom, his son. Or the grandfather would represent the son. And they would come and say, "My son says that he's going to be a good father. He's going to not be abusive. He's going to provide. He's going to so on and so on." And then he steps in the blood. And then the father of the bride will do the same thing. She promises to be a virgin. She promises to be a good wife. Promises to be faithful. And then he steps in the blood. And what's happening here is they're saying, if my son or my daughter doesn't actually do these things, then you can do this to me. You can kill me. So it's not the one who did the wrong thing that gets killed. It's the family member, the greater. So in the covenant between Abram and God, God is the greater, and Abraham is the lesser. And God's setting up a covenant for them. And there's a pool of blood now in the middle. Abraham's falling into a sleep. And Abraham sees this in a dream. God's saying, "I promise you, I'm going to give you a nation. I'm going to give you land. I'm going to give you all these things. If I don't do it, you can hold me accountable and kill me." And then Abraham, it says, falls into a dark, dreadful, terrible sleep where he realizes what he's getting himself into, because his side of the covenant is that he has to be blameless. He has to be perfect. And not just him, but all of his descendants have to be perfect. And Abraham's like, "Yeah, I can do this. We can do this." And we know that it's that Abraham has to be blameless, because we see it in Genesis 17, where it says, Abraham was 99 years old, and the Lord appeared to Abraham and said to him, "I am the Lord Almighty. Walk in my ways and be blameless. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and I will make you exceedingly numerous. So be blameless." So we know that that is Abraham's side of the bargain here. And so he's in this covenant relation, or about to begin this covenant with God, and he's about to step in the blood and say, "Yeah, I can do this. I can be blameless. We're going to do this, guys." And just as he's about to step in it, we see two symbols appear in the sky. So we read this in Genesis 15, 17 to 18. "When the sun set and it was very dark, there appeared a smoking oven and a flaming torch which passed between those two pieces," which were the sacrifice pieces. "On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram." All we see are two symbols, and if we don't understand the symbols, we miss it all. Here's two symbols, the smoking oven. God's the first one to step into the blood. The smoke represents him. You always see smoke representing God in the Bible. It doesn't represent man. It's depicted on Mount Sinai, the smoking mountain. So God steps in. That's his symbol. Next, a flaming torch appears in the sky. Fire. Fire never represents man. Never. We see it represent God. We see it represent the Holy Spirit, for sure. So God steps in and says, "Abraham, don't put your foot in the blood. You can't be perfect. Your descendants sure as heck can't be perfect. I'm going to step in the blood. And at that very moment, God sentences his son to death on a cross thousands of years later. And this is the first time we really see it. We see God's plan. And when the sacrificial system is created many years later by Moses, for 1,200 years, the sacrificial system goes on. And at 9 and 3, a sacrifice is made every single day for 1,200 years in the temple, all to say, God, you promised that you are going to step in because I'm not perfect. So you are going to do this for me. And then we see Jesus come on the scene. And at 9 o'clock, he's beaten and hung on a cross. And at 3 o'clock, he dies. Finished. No more sacrificial system. Jesus paid the price to make us blameless. And you need to see that. It has to move from your head to your heart. You have to see that Jesus does this in your heart, because you have to realize that he calls you blameless when you don't feel like it, because it's about who you are, not what you're doing. And you have to see it not only for you, because God is sitting out there, this incredible great shepherd we have is sitting out there calling to his lost sheep, I love you guys, I love you. I know you're lost in this world. I know you think that I hate you, because sometimes my Christian followers who call themselves Christians hate you, but I don't. I call you blameless before you even are, because you're just lost. You're just lost, and they just need their identity told to them. But here's the problem, is that we often don't believe that we are blameless in Christ, that we have made pure heart, holy, peacemakers. But this is who God sees us as, and we don't believe it about ourselves because we're so caught up with our emotion, our stuff. We don't see it. Oh, we failed today. Oh, God, I'm sorry. I'm not good enough. Oh, I got this theology of depravity that says I'm a sinner and I'm never going to be good enough until I die. Sorry. That's not how it works. He calls you good enough now because he wants you to realize that you need to go out and call those other people good enough. Call out the gold. Call out the truth. Call out life into people. And he wants you to see this so bad that he created this incredible story. And I don't believe it's a story, but it's the book of Hosea. And Hosea is probably the last place that we would look for a story about purity, because it's a very impure story. So there's a prophet, Old Testament prophet, by the name of Hosea, and he marries a wife. His wife's name is Gomer. And Gomer turns out to be an adulterous woman. And she has 3 children in adultery, and these children get some pretty bad names. The first one is Jezreel, which is all to do about Israel's sin. It led to a bloody defeat in a battle at the Valley of Jezreel. So, reminder, you're sinners. And then he has a second son, a second child, and it's a daughter. And her name is Lo Ruhamah. It means not accepted. You're not accepted because you were a sinner. Because you didn't want your true husband. And then there's a third child named Lo Ami, not my people. These are not my people because they disregarded me. So everything in Hosea is a picture of what God is doing in Israel. And I believe it's a true story with Hosea, and that's why God actually calls this prophet, because he has this wife who is caught in adultery. And so Hosea does what you would do to an adulterous wife. He says, I'm sorry, goodbye, I divorce you. But time passes, and his wife, Gomer, continues in her sin, continue getting worse and worse off, and he has pity on her. He's in love with her, it's his wife. He's being treated like trash, being used, being destroyed. And in his loving mercy and kindness, he goes to find her, and he buys her back for 13 shekels of silver and some bread. And he brings her back, and he just says, you don't need to do that anymore. You don't need to do that. You're my wife. I take you back. I remarry you. And I just want you to see how much I love you. I want you to to experience my love for you and understand the true identity that I gave you. And so time passes, and eventually she realizes that her husband really was the provider, that he was the one that she should have stayed with the whole time. And it's a picture of God's incredible love that calls out the good, the best, sees the best until we see it ourselves. He died for us while we were still sinners. Hosea 2 says this, and it's incredible because all this stuff happens. Gomer is found out to be adulterous. She has these three children that aren't Hosea's, that are children of her adultery. And right away, as soon as all this stuff happens, God places this in chapter 2, and it's talking about Israel. It says, the number of people of Israel shall be like the sands of the sea, cannot be measured or counted. And instead of being told, you are not my people, they shall be called children of the living God. The people of Judah and the people of Israel shall assemble together and appoint one head over them, and they shall rise from the ground, for marvelous shall be the day of Jezreel. O, call your brothers, my people, and your sisters, lovingly accepted. He sees the best before Israel ever turns around. For years, Israel walks away from God and goes after idols, their other lovers. But God calls them out as who he truly sees them to be. So this is a picture of how God sees his creation. He extends his mercy and kindness, wrapping them in purity while they're still sinning, so that they can see the image that they're created in. So let's step back and let's look at the bigger picture here. It's impossible for us, apart from God, to be blameless. It's impossible. So God sends his son, who has an identity from God that is pure and spotless. He's the pure and spotless lamb. And God loved you so much that Jesus decided to die on a cross while you were still sinning. And all those who put their faith in this lamb, Jesus, will be given a new identity, blameless. So that's God's part. That's our identity. That's the identity of Christ, preparing us for our own identity. So what's our role in being pure of heart? And we do have one. When you believe in Jesus Christ, the scriptures tell you to die to your flesh and become raised from the dead with Christ. And we see this in Colossians 3:3. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ. It's not you that live anymore. It's not your flesh. It's not your impurity. It's your purity in Christ. And it's no longer you who live, but Christ who lives in you. And this concept is so incredibly revolutionary for Paul of being in Christ that he can't stop talking about it. If you actually read all the epistles, it's all about being Christ. In Christ, this is what you are. In Christ, you can do this. And if you actually look, he really doesn't talk about the historical Jesus at all. He doesn't talk about anything of Jesus' life and ministry except to say that he died on a cross for our sins and his own personal Damascus Road experience. In Ephesians alone, 28 times he talks about being in Christ. And here's a short little snippet. In Christ, we receive every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. These are promises. This is what he says about you, his beloved. In Christ, we receive every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. In Christ, we are chosen to be holy and blameless before the foundation of the world. In Christ, we are adopted as sons. In Christ, we have been redeemed and forgiven of sins. In him, we have an inheritance. In Christ, we were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. In Christ, we have salvation. In Christ, we are seated in heavenly places far above every other rule and authority. And Christ has everything else under his feet. That's who you are in Christ. It's amazing. It's incredible. And it has to become you. Paul is reminding us that the fight of the good faith is a fight, because there's only one way to get there. And it's in Christ. It's in relationship with the author and perfecter of your faith 24/7. Not on your knees, but in surrender. In everything you do. It doesn't matter where you are. It's not about going to a prayer closet 3, 6, 12 hours a day. It's about doing life, your marriage, your job, everything in communion with God. And because he wants to speak, he wants to transform lives all around you. And if you're not out in the world, then you're really no worth the good. This is a relationship that bears fruit, causing you to be pure in heart. I'm not saying pruning doesn't happen. I'm not saying that if you're here today and you're not married and you're sleeping with somebody, that it's not wrong. You need to see that it is wrong. But I'm not going to call out the wrong, because Jesus is going to call it out if you want a relationship with him. Jesus, if you really want to know the author and perfecter of your faith, if you really want to be like him, he's going to call out the junk. And us as the body of Christ are just there to help you along the way, really. We're there to come lovingly alongside of you and help you to be like Jesus. So it's not about asceticism. It's not about hurting oneself, breaking down one's body, trying to prove something. It's not about legalism. And it's not about self-help, because none of those things will help you. It's only in Christ that we find that we can become pure in heart. So, I need my phone, and there's tons of wires in my way. I'm going to read from, actually, I think it's up here. It's John 14, 15 to 21. There you go. Read this. If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans, but I will come to you yet a little while, and the world will see me no more. But you will see me because I live. You also will live. In that day, you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I in you. And whoever has my commandments and keeps them, it's he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him, and I will manifest myself to him. Man, it's a whole jumble of words, but this is basically what he's saying, is that you'll keep my commandments, but you won't do it on your own strength. You'll do it in Christ, because Christ is your strength if you're in Christ. If you learn to communicate with God 24/7, then you will obey my commandments, because there's nothing you can do outside of that. There's nothing you want to do. And the Father will give you a helper to do this. It's the Holy Spirit. Here's the world. The world tries to follow the commandments of God without even realizing it. They try to follow the commandments of God, because a lot of people try to be good, moral people, but they cannot do it without the Spirit. And the Spirit is only given to you through Christ. And if you don't have a relationship with Christ, you won't receive the Spirit. And then it says, down here it says that the Father will love those who are in Christ, and that the Father will allow Christ to reveal himself. What is revealing himself? Being God. So you're in Christ. You've been made pure. You're loved by the Father so much. And Jesus says, okay, now you're going to see me. You're going to see me in your workplaces. You're going to see me everywhere you go, because we're in communion all the time. And so this really brings us to full circle. The title of the message, Believing is Seeing. Believing in me, you will see me. Our salvation is incredibly great, because we've been called into a state of being and not of doing. I want to leave you with this today that, well, let me go here first, I guess. You are the salt and the light of the world. Let me pick on this. The salt, and this is right after what we read in the Beatitudes, you are the salt of the earth, not because you bring taste and spice to the life of people. It's because, historically speaking, salt was an additive to the main fuel source of the Israeli people at that time living in this area. The main fuel source is dung, dried up dung, animal poop. And they would add the salt to the dung because it allows the fuel to burn hotter and longer. But once all the salt is burned up, your fuel source is gone. This world is the animal dung that I'm speaking about. It is. It really is. And you are the salt, and you're told to go mix with it. Because where you go, darkness cannot be. But if you have a distorted view of who you are in Christ, you won't be that salt. Because you won't even know who you are. So, let's pray. I'll ask Cole to come on up here. Father, I just ask, Lord, that you would help us to see that there really is no fear of becoming like the world when we are in Christ. That it's the world that needs the fear of becoming like you instead, because our identity is contagious, far more contagious than the sin of this world, Lord. And so, Father, we just ask for incredible boldness, God, knowing how great a salvation that we have in Christ and that we have been wrapped up in you in purity, hidden away from any sin, any temptation, hidden away in Christ from the wrath that will come one day, but was not coming right now because God's grace is what rules on this earth. Father, we thank you so much for that grace. Help us not to be afraid, to be bold, God. Help us to be bold in our workplaces, bold in our homes, standing firm on the truth of our identity, walking in our identity, God. I pray that every single person here would just hold on to one thing today, that they are made complete and perfect in you, that you are the one who started the work, you are the one who finished the work, and even now while we are being sanctified, it is in Christ, that it's nothing, that we're nothing apart from you. We really aren't. Help us to grab hold of that today, God, and to understand that the hope of our salvation, the reason that we are victorious and more than conquerors, God, is because we already have the outcome of our faith. We already have freedom. We already are blameless, even now when we don't always feel like it. Help us not to be dictated and moved by our feelings, God, but moved by the truth of your word. Help us to be in our word, God, to love the word, because it always leads us to the living word. You are the living word, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just pray that you would bless everyone in this congregation today, God, and that they would go with a heart of surrender and a love that just bursts out of them, God, that a love that cannot be offended, a love that cannot be held back, a love that just pours out, God. And wherever they are, Father, that they would just desire to see your kingdom advance. Praise you, God. You are worthy of all our thanks, God. And we continue to just thank you for the things that we are still struggling with today. We thank you for them because you're going to do an incredible work through them. I give you thanks in your name. Amen.